A disclaimer before I start any of this, I do want to make it very clear that I'm not trying to insult Aaron Hunter, the group, or anything like that. I just wanted to do this for the sake of curiosity to see, hey, what if these humanized cats were actually real cats? What would they have looked like? A lot of the realistic designs take away a lot of the creativity from the original design, so, you know, I'm very aware of that. I'm not trying to try and gatekeep the Warriors community and be like, you can't draw them that way anymore. It's all realistic. So, wanted to say that before starting so nobody gets offended. A second thing that I need to address is like some weird complicated cat genetics that end up happening because there's a lot of weird rules for them for their coats and stuff like that and their eye colors, and I don't want 50 different people to ask me the same question, so I'm just going to answer a lot of the most asked questions at the very beginning right here. So here we go. So the basic rules of cat genetics is that there are only two colors for cats, technically. There are only two different colors for the tabby marking, which is what most of them are. And the two different colors is ginger and black. Except you might get a little bit confused whenever I talk about those because black doesn't really mean that it looks black. Inside nature, there is nothing that is naturally black. It really is just dark brown, except it would call it black because that's what it's coded for. So whenever they are a quote-unquote black tabby, that actually means that they look like a brown tabby, like this. Ginger is a little bit easier because, you know, it's just orange and then lighter orange, but the reason why tabbies are like that is because whenever it calls it a tabby cat, that basically means to get the original color as a stripe and then a lighter version of that color as the background, and since it's not actually perfectly black, it just turns out to be brown instead. The next sort of rule is that, if there are two differently colored tabbies, like if there's a ginger tabby and a black tabby that mate and make babies, then the female babies get both of the colors from the parents, and the males only get the color from the mama. So the reason behind this is a lot of, like, it's a really long science-y explanation about chromosome counts and stuff like that, but I won't make you sit through that. Just the end result is that the females turn into tortoiseshells, and the males only take the mother's color. So another small rule is that the dilution gene is a thing. So dilution gene is a recessive gene that basically means to make the color paler, which is why there can be four different colors of tabbies, even though I've recently said that it was only two of the ginger and the black tabby. So whenever a ginger gets the diluted gene, then it turns into a light ginger, sort of like cream colored. And whenever a black tabby gets the dilution gene, it turns into a gray tabby. Now you might be asking, Kiwi, what are you talking about? You just said that the black tabby appears brown. Why would it turn gray if it has a dilution gene? Shouldn't it be light brown? Actually, that is incorrect. It's because the dilution gene also turns down the saturation, so it appears gray to us. That's how you get a gray. That's how you get a gray tabby. You have a black tabby, and then you have the dilution gene and make gray. Woo! So the next little rule is that there's a weird rule about that there's two ways to get white cats. The first way is a special snowflake gene way, and it usually results in deafness. I'm sure that you've heard of this before. It's where the eyes are blue and they're usually deaf. And the other way to get a white cat without the danger of them being deaf, and also they can't have blue eyes this way, is that they have a tuxedo gene that's all the way turned up to the highest level. Small disclaimer, this is not actually what this gene is called. It's a really complicated name, like white recessive or something like that. So I just called it tuxedo because it's easier to understand, because the cats look like this. They have most of their normal color and the white splotches on their bellies and their paws and stuff. So whenever a cat has a tuxedo gene, usually there's like a certain level about how much of the cat is white, because, you know, you've seen cats with the mittens pattern and then cats with most of their legs being white, and then the white cats that I'm talking about, where it's as if their entire body was just one big white spot, and they don't have to worry about the deafness thing. So, yeah, that's two different ways to get white cats. So, the next one is, let me read this. Okay, so I'm gonna be ignoring all the special breeds other than Sasha, because special breeds are usually the, like, really, really specific type of guys that are, like, the blue Russians or that solid brown cat or something like that. And that is probably pretty unlikely to actually happen in the wild, because all these cats are, you know, bred to hunt and stuff. They're more likely to be calico than anything. So the only cat that I've actually made an exception for this to be a specific breed has been Sasha, because it makes sense, because being a kitty pet, she would be a special breed, because you can, you know, buy that. So, The next little section of rules is that, for me, there's actually four different options of what a cat can look like with each of the traits that get passed on. I usually decided to pick whatever trait was the closest to the original design. So, like, if I have a chance to make Jayfeather either gray or brown, I'll pick to make gray because Jayfeather is gray in the original series. So, the next little thing is that, wait a second, I need to read this, sorry, I get stage fright a lot. So, oh yeah, I only went back one generation, by the way. I only started at, like, about Jake's level, I think, and just coded him as if he was a real cat. Because, you know, I didn't want to go back hundreds of generations tracking what the original design would have been or anything. That would be ridiculous. So, other than that, you'll hear me using the word dominant gene and recessive gene a lot. Dominant gene just basically means that it's the top, and recessive gene just means that it's the bottom. So if there's a dominant gene, a top next to a bottom, a recessive gene, usually the top overpowers the bottom and then it becomes the top gene. So usually the top gene is more likely to happen. Anyway, I think that's about it. I should probably just go on before I keep on rambling. Sorry, I just needed to put this beginning over here just so people didn't comment the same exact question over and over and over again. If you have any questions beyond these, just, you know, ask me and I'll probably try to answer. And here we go! Alright, so here are the first two cats that I did, Firestar and Sandstorm. Also, sorry if the drawings are bad, I'm not experienced with drawing cats, I usually draw humans. Anyway, so this is the canon designs with some artistic liberty thrown in here and there. Yay. And this is the realistic designs. Immediately you can tell that something isn't right here. No! The prophecy! It's gone! This is by far the most devastating loss to the realistic designs. The reason why Firestar is a black tabby now is because both of his parents were tabbies, a ginger and a black tabby. And since Firestar is male, he was only able to inherit the black tabby from his mother, Nutmeg. So unfortunately, I had to nerf Firestar's flame-colored pelt, and this is very sad. If they wanted Firestar to be ginger, they had to make Nutmeg the ginger gene carrier, not his father. So this is devastating. It's truly very sad what happened to Firestar's design. Sandstorm still looks pretty much the same, but she had both the ginger and the black tabby gene, so it's just diluted to make the ginger cream and the black gray. So, yeah, we're off to a great start here. Okay, so this is the next two casts that I did. These are Squirrelflight and Leafpool. These are the canon designs with, you know, some artistic liberty put in. And here are the realistic designs. So they weren't nearly as devastating as Firestar's loss of the flame-colored pelt. Except we do have them both be calicos now. They are both calicos because they were both tabbies from their parents, and their parents had both the black and the ginger gene. Sandstorm had both of them, and Firestar only had one, so they were able to get both of them, obviously. The only difference is that they aren't diluted like Sandstorm, because the dilution gene is recessive, and Firestar did not have the dilution gene, so he wasn't able to give it to the kids. They can carry it over to their children, though, except they cannot show it on themselves. This design isn't really too bad. I kind of like how they look, even though it doesn't match the actual characters. This design is not too bad. Calico is a pretty good coat color, especially since they're inside the wild. They would be able to hunt way easier like this. I'm not saying to, like, change it to this or anything, except it's not too bad. It doesn't, like, mess up the story completely, like how Firestar's did. It's truly, truly sad what happened to him. A moment of silence. And moving on! Next little family tree branch that I'm going to be focusing on is Princess's side of the family. I'm just going to get this section done with. So we have Cloudtail, Brightheart, and Whitewing. These are their canon designs with, of course, some artistic liberty thrown in. And these are the realistic designs. Obviously, you can tell that Cloudtail is the one that changed the most. So, you know, remember before whenever I told you about there's two ways to get a white cat, one is the deaf way and the other isn't the deaf way? So since we don't know who Cloudtail's father is, I decided to make him a white cat except not in the deaf way, which means putting on the tuxedo gene really, really high, so it's just like the entire cat is one big white spot. So, since Princess also had a mittens gene, I decided that it would probably dial it down a little bit, except Cloudtail would be able to have most of him be white, with only a little bit of black tabby from his mother, Princess. So, There is a little bit of a genetic mutation that I added onto him just for fun. You know, I made the tip of his tail white too, even though usually that doesn't happen with the tuxedo gene. But, you know, I just wanted to do it for fun since, you know, yay, the name would fit better. Brightheart doesn't look too devastatingly different or anything. She's just a lighter, diluted ginger tabby that's ticked. And Whitewing is another diluted calico cat, kind of similar to what Sandstorm was. She just has more white on her because her dad had more of the tuxedo gene. So, yeah, that's what they look like. They're a nice little happy family. Woo! Okay, so the next people we're looking at is Whitewing's babies. So these are Dovewing and Ivypool, and, you know, these are the canon designs with some extra artistic liberty. I was very proud of the ear tufty things of Dovewing. And this is the realistic design. The one who has changed the most is Dovewing, and that is because a solid gray cat is actually a really specific breed because you have to have the solid gene, which is recessive, and then the dilution gene on top of that, which is also recessive. It's very hard to get a solid gray cat, especially from a calico cat. So, unfortunately, Dovewing is no longer a solid gray cat, but she is a diluted tortoiseshell as well as Ivypool. Ivypool is also a diluted tortoiseshell. They're both calicos, so they have the mittens pattern and stuff. Ivypool didn't really change that much. That still looks pretty acceptable. She just has the extra cream-colored spots inside the diluted black, so yay. They didn't really change that much. It's just really sad that Dovewing also lost her fluff. Another great loss. Dovewing is no longer fluffy. No. So, next person. Alright, now that we're done with Cloudtail's side of the family, we're moving over to Firestar's side of the family. These are Leafpool's kittens, Jayfeather, Lionblaze, and Hollyleaf. So these are the original canon designs, plus some extra artistic details. I was unnecessarily proud of Hollyleaf's splashed white paw because, you know, we love foreshadowing caught red pawed. Anyway, so these are the original designs, and these are the realistic designs. These are probably the ones that I don't like as much as any of the others because it really puts a lot of the creativity that they had from the original designs just down the drain. It's completely gone. And also the worst part is Lionblaze lost his fluff. We've lost another fluffy cat. No! The reason why fluffy cats keep on getting nerfed is because the fluffy gene is actually recessive. So usually they have short fur instead of long fur. Anyway, other than that, the pelt colors are really different. Actually, I had to fact-check myself about this, except if a tortoiseshell cat like Leafpool has a male kitten baby, that doesn't make it a tortoiseshell male, even though the male is supposed to only get the tabby color from the female. Usually it decides on what the male baby's color is based on whatever the father's was, either a black gene or a ginger gene. So because Crowfeather was a solid black cat, that mixed up with Leafpool's tortoiseshell turned out to be black tabby for both Jayfeather and Lionblaze. The only difference is that Crowfeather and Leafpool both were carrying the diluted gene, even though they didn't show it on themselves. Crowfeather got it from Ashfoot, and Leafpool got it from Sandstorm. So I decided since a black diluted tabby would be gray, I decided to give that to Jayfeather. That's why he's the one that didn't change that much, other than just specific little details. He's pretty much the same concept, you know, gray tabby. So with Lionblaze, I didn't dilute him because I guess brown-looking tabby is closer to gold. Turns out gold is actually not a natural fur color for cats. Warrior cats managed to convince an entire generation that gold was a cat color. Anyway, so Hollyleaf ended up getting both of the tortoiseshell genes and stuff just because, you know, males got the black tabby. I managed to dilute Jayfeather. Their eyes are, of course, very different just based on them being mixed up with the... I don't actually know what Crowfeather's eye color is, but yeah, this is it. I shouldn't be rambling this long. These are the Power of Three. I don't really like these designs very much, but, you know, realism. Sorry, this one stomps out a lot of the creativity. Anyway, moving on before I talk any longer. So, once I finished with the Power 3, I decided to go back to Brambleclaw's side because I just wanted to do Tigerstar's family because I thought of a really good idea for Sasha. So now I felt obligated to also do Brambleclaw and Tawnypelt. So, here is Tigerstar, Brambleclaw, and Tawnypelt, their original canon designs, plus some, you know, artistic creativity, and there's the realistic designs. There's another big problem. This is another story-changing problem, and I think you can guess what it is. Brambleclaw's entire character is gone now. He doesn't look like his father anymore because His parents were both tabbies. Goldenflower was a diluted ginger, and Tiger Star was a black tabby, so he only got it from Goldenflower. So now Brambleclaw's whole personality is gone. So they should have either decided to, like, make Goldenflower also be a black tabby, or just decide to have Tawny Pelt be the Tiger Star clone that round. Anyway, so Brambleclaw looks very different. Maybe it would have actually been better if Tawny Pelt was the bad guy, because, you know, we don't have enough female villains. Anyway, so that's what we got. Tiger Star actually didn't change that much. They were actually correct about him. The only thing that really changed was his eye color. It changed from amber to hazel. Small, like, eye color gene thing for cats. They have three different eye colors that are mainly. There's the amber color gene, the green color gene, and the blue color gene. And the weird thing is that usually it's either dominant or recessive, except for some reason the green is actually a switch. So basically, I'm just going to put this inside Gen Z terms. The amber color gene is the top, the green is a switch, and the blue is a bottom. So whenever you get a switch and a top together, they kind of mix together to make hazel. But a green can overpower a blue, so you don't, like, get a teal colored eye or something like that. But it only happens, that's how hazel eyes are made for cats. Anyway. Whoa, moving on. Next, guys. I think this is the last one. Yep, Past Kiwi was correct. This is the last guys that I ended up doing. This is Mothwing and Hawk Frost. These are the original canon designs with, you know, some artistic liberty thrown in. And here's the realistic designs. These are actually my favorite out of all of the realistic designs, because the reason why they're like this is because the color point gene mixed up with the tabby gene makes it as if it was a tabby, but only at the tips of the cat, like this. And I just really, really like this coloration pattern thing going on here, especially Hawk Frost. So I think that these are actually probably my favorite. These are definitely my favorite realistic designs. Because the color point gene is a dominant gene, it's usually able to carry through many generations. And also, for some weird reason, they only have blue eyes. I don't exactly know why, it's just only have blue eyes, so Hawk Frost manages to keep his blue eyes, and Mothwing's amber eyes turn into blue instead, so.
Alright, so that's about it. This is the only amount of cats that I did, just this part of Firestar's family tree, because I didn't really think that I should spend an entire month doing every single cat, you know? So, I just did this part, and, I don't really know exactly why I did this part. I'm not turning into a Warrior Cats channel, in case if you're worried. The usual subscribers are probably worried right now because they don't know what Warrior Cats is, but don't worry, I'm not going to turn into a Warrior Cats channel. I just wanted to do this for the sake of curiosity. I managed to hyper-focus on things for absolutely no reason, and this week it was Warrior Cats, so this is the product of that. If you liked it, then tell me which one was your favorite realistic design and which one was your least favorite realistic design. Just, you know, I want to see, just for the sake of curiosity, how much everyone liked them. The one that I liked the least was obviously Firestar, and the one that I liked the most was definitely Hawk Frost. So, yay, hope you like it, hope you liked it, otherwise you, you know, wasted like 10 minutes of your time. Sorry about that if you didn't like this. Bye, love you all. Woo, realistic cats.